Now we're ready to return to the fundamental question of the day. Similar to patterns of sequential hermaphroditism and sex determination, sex itself must confer individual advantages that outweigh the apparent costs. Looking at the evolution of sex, it's a good idea for us to start with the bacteria, because sex and reproduction are different processes in bacteria. And it turns out that many fundamental aspects of bacterial sex clearly confer individual advantage. First, there's the opportunity to spread genes to other individuals. Secondly, there's the opportunity to repair damaged DNA. The first case, here we have our two bacteria. In this case, though, we're going to see what's called selfish conjugation, where one bacterium imposes its genes on the other. So as before, we have the tube that allows the transfer of genetic material between the two individuals. But in this case, only the blue chromosome passes its genes to the other individual, which are ultimately integrated into that other individual's genome. And so we clearly now have a selfish spread of genetic material by sex. The second one is called transformation, and this has to do with DNA repair. Here we have a cartoon of a bunch of bacteria in a flask. Each has their intact circular chromosome with a blue circle. Now, if we expose them to some insult, like radiation, like ultraviolet light or something else, this will break the chromosome. So now we have damaged DNA. Now, in this situation, this is really hard on the bacteria and it will kill them. But if we do this again and we allow at the bottom of the flask a supply of bits and pieces of chromosomes of other dead bacteria, if there's radiation again damaging the living bacteria, they'll look around and get some spare parts from the dead bacteria and incorporate that into their own genomes and thus repair their broken DNA. So transformation is where bacteria can repair their DNA by having sex with the dead. That's great for bacteria, and bacteria are relatively easy to explain why they have sex. But let's get to the diploids. This is the really puzzling case where we have that twofold cost of meiosis. Short-term advantages in diploids are likely to derive from two different sources. First is from mutation deletion. Let's take two scenarios here. We have our asexual organism with its diploid genome. So you've got homologous partners of the chromosomes here, a long homologous pair and a short homologous pair. And you have two sexual individuals that are likewise about to reproduce. Now, there's always mutations. It's these little red dots on the ends of each chromosome meant to indicate that during the lifespan of this individual, it's obtained two new mutations. Okay, and that's true for all three of our breeding individuals. But in the asexual, they're all passed on. There's no way to get rid of those mutations. So the asexual offspring will inherit both of its mother's mutations. Now, in the sexual pair, things are different. Because of meiosis, with independent assortment, the chromosomes end up in the gametes in random order. And so by chance, there happen to be some haploid gametes that don't possess either of the mother's new mutations, or maybe they're missing one of them in two cases here. So in both cases, both the mother and the father are producing gametes that sometimes don't have either of the parents' original mutations. So when they reproduce, there is a small but not zero chance that they'll pass on neither mutations to their children. And a fairly good chance, at least one in four, that the offspring will have only one of the parents' mutations. So a proportion of sexual offspring will have fewer mutations inherited from its parents than will the asexual lineage. And you extend this through time, generation after generation, the asexual lineage is going to accumulate more and more and more mutations and can't get rid of them, whereas the level of mutations is held somewhat low within the sexual lineage. Okay, the second major advantage to diploids derives from a process that we'll see in much more detail in the last few lectures of the course, but let me introduce to you today the concept of host-parasite coevolution. And here we're going to be thinking about our individual that engages in sex as a host species that gets infected by much smaller organisms. So here we have, again, our diploid organism that's ready to breed, okay? And the little blue dot is like a virus or a bacteria that is capable of overcoming the immune system or the, otherwise the defense system of the host. And this is likely to be the same for asexual and sexual individuals that eventually a parasite finds our cells and is able to infect them. Now, in the case of the asexuals, the offspring is identical to the mother, and so any parasites that infected the mother are already around, ready to infect the offspring as soon as it's born, and then they can evolve, because they're so small and they have such a rapid reproductive rate, they can readily get better and better at infecting the particular genotype they find themselves on. So through time, these asexuals are likely to be much, much more sensitive to parasitic infection than earlier generations. Now, in contrast with sexual reproduction, if we have a female who, by chance, has been infected by a parasite, she might be able to find a healthy husband. And in the population at that time, there might be a male who is resistant to whatever disease that she's susceptible to. So if she then is able to obtain a resistant genome for her offspring from her husband, then her children will temporarily escape from parasitic infection. And this goes on generation after generation, so the sexual lineage is able to obtain new genetic material from healthy individuals in the population, selectively, and pass it on to their offspring, and thus maintain much higher resistance to disease generation after generation. Now, this idea of host-parasite coevolution is often viewed as an arms race. So the parasite, the bacteria, the virus, being so small, it has a generation time of maybe just a few minutes. And mutations are constantly arising in the parasite, so they can find new mutations that eventually will overcome the resistance of the host. The host species, on the other hand, is a much larger, longer-lived organism, and it may be years between generations. And so an analogy of the problem faced by hosts is often raised from the story of Alice in Wonderland, where Alice ends up in a rather uncomfortable place, having to negotiate this really obnoxious queen, and the rules keep changing. Everybody keeps having to do something new and different to keep her happy. And there's a famous line in Alice in Wonderland that says something like, "It takes all the running you can do to keep in the same place." So you have to go faster and faster and faster. You're not going anywhere. But because, in our case of host-parasite coevolution, the parasite's evolving so fast to pick up with you, you have to keep finding new ways to obtain resistance for your lineage so that you at least don't get lost in that race with the parasites. So as hosts become adapted to parasites, parasites are going to evolve new lines of attack, and sexual reproduction allows host lineages to adapt more quickly. Now we can look at this experimentally. This is a lovely set of experiments here where our host species is a nematode. It's a small worm called Caenorhabditis, and it's an organism we'll see repeatedly through the course. It's a very small, simple organism. It only lives for a couple of months maximum. And it is infected itself by bacteria. And the bacteria lifespan, again, is just a few minutes. So bacteria can evolve to infect this nematode. So what we have is a host species, the nematode, that is subject to bacterial infection. So this electron micrograph shows where the bacteria have invaded the nematode's body. So, what we have in an experimental setting here is repeated breeding in the laboratory of the nematodes. And sometimes these nematodes reproduce sexually. So sperm and egg meet from two different nematodes. They have a new offspring. But nematodes are also capable of asexual reproduction. And so what we're going to look at is what gives rise to more asexual reproduction and what gives rise to more sexual reproduction. And we're going to look at this in terms of the mortality caused by the bacteria. What we're going to see is that through time, the sexual lineage is less bothered by the bacteria, whereas the asexual lineage is more bothered by the bacteria. So, sexually reproducing hosts evolved to become more resistant to the bacterial infection. So we just allow these things to coexist generation after generation, and these are always reproducing sexually, then the mortality rate they suffer from bacterial infection declines from about 45% down to about 25% over 30 generations. On the other hand, if these nematodes are enticed in the laboratory to only reproduce asexually, then the bacteria are getting better and better at infecting that host because the host genome doesn't change and the bacteria evolved to become more harmful in these asexual hosts. So if there's not a moving target for the bacteria to track, they are able to get better and better at making the nematodes sick. On the other hand, if the host reproduces sexually, its genetics are changing every generation, it's a moving target now, and it's able to escape the most harmful effects of infection. Now, these experiments are incredibly insightful because they look at different combinations of evolution between the host and the parasite. First, let's just look at the background, what the nematode would do if it was never being infected by the bacteria. And so we're going to look at generation after generation after generation, where the host is not subject to bacterial infection. And in that case, what we see is that there's no sexual reproduction. The nematodes are perfectly happy to reproduce asexually when they're not being troubled by bacterial infection. So that's this red line over here. This is the proportion of nematodes that reproduce sexually, and they're not. Okay, so in the absence of the bacteria, they don't care about having sex. Now we're going to have a very interesting manipulation where the nematodes are being subjected to the bacteria, so they're being experimentally infected, but the bacteria that's being used to infect the host is taken out of a refrigerator. So there's a large pot of the bacteria, and every generation the nematode is subjected to that same bacteria that originally was around at the start of the experiment. So generation after generation, it's getting the same bacteria, okay? What happens here is that at first, the host can't cope with the bacteria. So it engages in a lot of sex, but it reaches a point where now it's pretty good at resisting the parasites. And so it gets less and less interested in sex, and it goes back to being asexual. So in this case, the host was able to evolve to a new level of resistance to the parasite, and even though the bacteria is still there, it doesn't harm it so much anymore, so it relies less and less on sex. In the third experiment, the parasite is put in and allowed to evolve. So the parasite descends from one generation to the next, and so we have an evolving parasite with an evolving host. And in this case, the host again changes over to sexual reproduction right as soon as it's infected, but now it has to maintain sexual reproduction. And after a while, they're all reproducing sexually all the time because they can no longer escape the parasite because the parasite is evolving to cause problems. So this is a wonderful case of how the host has to go quicker and quicker. It's like the Red Queen. It has to keep going, finding new genetic variants within its population to resist the parasitic infection because the parasite is evolving as fast as it can. If the parasite is prevented from evolving in this very special manipulation here, then the host only engages in sexual reproduction for a while and then it goes back to being asexual. So, sex and host is favored when infected by the parasites, but it only persists when the parasites also evolve. Now, asexual reproduction, having descendants that are identical to the parents, in a way is very much like modern agriculture, where we have these vast farms and everybody produces just one crop. And it's well known within monocultures that once a disease strikes one part of the wheat field, since the only host out there is other wheat, it will spread very rapidly. And so leaf rust is a huge problem in terms of crop production in wheat. There's a similar problem with a parasite called red leaf that infects blueberries. And so even though these are not genetically identical, they are more identical in a monoculture than they would be if you had a variety of different species living close together. So if we have this problem with a monoculture, imagine what it would be like if these were all asexually reproducing, and these would all not only be the same species, but they'd be exactly the same genotype. And once a parasite can infect any one of these wheat, then it could spread to everything else. So disease is a huge threat to hosts in natural systems. So, summarizing sex in diploids. Empirical data suggests that there are strong individual advantages both from mutation deletion because of independent assortment. Those novel mutations in the parents can be eliminated from a portion of their gametes, and also from the kinds of parasite resistance we just saw in the nematodes with the bacteria. If you combine those two, theoretical models suggest that together, the advantages of mutation deletion and parasite resistance can be more than twofold. So in other words, a sexually reproducing individual can have more than twice as many surviving offspring, thus overcoming those twofold costs of meiosis. Putting all these things together, now we have a much better understanding of the evolution of sex. In bacteria, many aspects of bacterial sex clearly confer individual advantage. For selfish genes to get into one individual to another, and for DNA repair in the case of transformation. In the diploids, the advantages come from mutation deletion and from host-parasite coevolution.